please stand on your feet. The Bible says, give honor to whom honor is due. God is telling us who he put in position, who he put in place. We should honor them. Amen? So now we're going to honor the man of God, Reverend Dr. Theophilus Lefro. Amen. Amen.
But the crowns of glory await only those who endure to the end.
Yes.
At that time. I got up and breakfast, talking to myself. I have got my message. So I got dressed and started running to the bus stop to catch my bus. When the Kenneth Jenner was the guy who saw me at the bus stop and took me to the library to write to this message. So, Kenneth, you are blessed today in Jesus' name. For rescuing the man of God. Amen. Yeah, in this parable, our Lord is telling us what it costs to gain eternal life. Salvation is free and we assume to be true. But can we get salvation without working for it? You may challenge me with the claim that we all, after all, have been saved by grace anyway. As we also read in Ephesians 2:8-9, which reads that, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourself, it is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. Now the scripture also said in Hebrews 11:6, that without faith, it is impossible to please God. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he would not see death. And he was not found because God took him up. For he obtained the witness that before his being taken up, he was pleasing to God. And without faith, it is impossible to please him, for he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. By faith, Noah being warned by God about things not yet seen, in reference to Peter and us, for the salvation of the world, by which he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. The Bible is very clear. As you read in the above scripture, it is a rewarder of those who seek him.
Amen.
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 If our salvation is based on the condition that we seek him, how then do we seek him? Do we have to make any sacrifices? Do we have to deny ourselves? And our treasures to seek him? These are the questions we shall be discussing this morning. The Lord said, as we read in Luke 9:62, no one, out of putting his hand to the plow and looking back to see for the kingdom of God.
Amen.
If I ask you this morning, how many here who are city dwellers who understand this parable? I am sure not many will be able to figure it out. The nearest example of the plow are the grass-cutting mowing machine we all see, especially during the summertime, by owners of houses driving or pushing them about to cut the lawn or grass. Once you set your few hands on the mowing machine with the motor running, you move forward without looking back until you complete your line. When this parable now applies to other humans, Jesus saw the way those who wanted to follow him were behaving. And we also read in Luke 6:7-62, as they were walking along the road, a man said to him, we follow you wherever you go. And Jesus replied, foxes have dens, and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. He said to another, follow me. But he replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. And Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead. But you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but what? Let me go back and say goodbye to my family. And Jesus replied, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit to study in the kingdom of God. When or what does the Lord mean by this statement? Oh, who are we having here this morning I assume, I accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. In that long, as you have been recognized as a follower of Christ, you are expected always to reflect all the virtues of Christ in you. What are these characters? Faithfulness, obedience, diligence, loyalty, humility, zeal of passion for things of God. Among those that the Lord is saying are not fit for the kingdom of God are those who, after receiving the good news, after embracing it and are given responsibilities in the church, but no sooner minor problems, anger, or loss after worldly things confront them instead of turning to Christ in prayer, and have that courage to command that Satan that is always behind all the followers of Christ to stand behind them, they backslide and become lost. They are like the falling autumn dry leaves, which wind is carrying in different directions. When they come to church, their heart and spirit are somewhere else. But inside they are very troubled and they are very unhappy. No one can save you except yourself. And the Lord has assured everyone in such a situation in Matthew 11:28, come to me. All you who labor and are heavily and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. It is never too late for any Christian brother or sister to come back into the fold of Christ. This is why the church is established. We are here for one another. If you cannot find that love and understanding in the church, then our faith is dead without words of love and charity. If we may claim we have faith, what works are expected of us so that our faith will not be dead even though while we are still alive? What does the Bible tell us in James 2:14-26? Faith without works is dead. What does it profit, my brethren? If someone says he has faith but does not have works, can faith save him?
Hallelujah!
If any brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, for you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit? Does also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is it dead? But someone will say, you have faith, and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works.
Yeah.
Amen. You believe that there is one God, you do well. Even the demons believe it too, and they tremble. But do you want to know, oh foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works? When he acquired Isaac his son on the altar, do you see that faith was working together with his works? And by what faith was made perfect? And this scripture was fulfilled which says Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. And he was called the friend of God.
Amen.
You see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith only. Likewise, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also.
Amen.
Now, the church made an appeal to us. for a token lady in front of a building fund, which will enable us to buy our own place of worship. The idea was warmly welcomed, even though not without some murmuring from some few members of due to faith, which we cannot help anyway, as they exist in any organization. But up to now, so many months have passed, we cannot count up to 7 members from the whole congregation who are fully paid off. Another appeal recently for the repair of the church fund was brought to our notice for voluntary donation at the Lost Churches of Bettyfield. We received the message, but we got short the Lord appeal out of our hearts to think about giving back to Christ what he rightly deserves, as this fund is also put to our own use. For how long? Shall we remain as if we don't care or understand that if God is blessing you and your family, we also need to be a blessing to the things belonging to God's house and also to be a blessing to others. My fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, we are then. Do we stand with Jesus Christ today? Being a Christian is an individual thing. I want you to know that. It's a personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
Amen. Yeah.
He is alive.
Yes. Amen.
I want to know and be known by you. No religion can save you. Nor can any denomination or any church save you. Only Jesus has the power to save you and give you eternal life.
Amen.
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 In the book of Romans, the Apostle Paul writes that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. As we follow the Bible, hear what happened. When the disciple Thomas encountered Jesus after he had been killed and was raised from the dead, remember that Thomas wasn't present the first time Jesus came to visit his disciples. After his resurrection, and Thomas did not believe that he was alive based on the testimony of the other. A week later, the disciples were in the house again and Thomas was with them. So, the doubts were unlocked. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be unto you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hand. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe."
Amen.
Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. For blessed are those who have not seen and you can't believe." And I thank God our own someone in this church have believed in us. Amen. Thank God for their life. Jesus is awesome. Amen. Jesus is in the miraculous things and many, many times in the presence of his disciples before he was taken into heaven. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Because Jesus is Lord, and Jesus is God, he hears our prayers, and we save you if you ask him. We believe this by faith. The Holy Spirit is a seal, it's a sign of that faith. And he provides the wisdom and the power we need for our daily living. But the question facing us today is, can we make Jesus Lord without knowing all the answers to every question? We might have having an unasked concerning our duties and responsibilities as followers of Christ? Can we let go of our self-gratification, but rather do good works to make a place for ourselves in the hereafter? And live moment by the Spirit of Christ? Can we humble ourselves as Thomas did and let Jesus be in charge of everything? If you can do this, Jesus will gladly receive you and begin that personal relationship with you. You can have confidence that he will do it.
Yeah.
Our Jesus said, in John 10, 25 to 10, the miracles that I do in my Father's name speak for me. But you do not believe because you are not my sheep.
Okay.
My sheep listen to my voice.
Hallelujah.
And they follow me. I give them eternal life. And they shall never perish.
Amen.
No one can snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all.
Amen.
No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand.
Amen.
I am the Father of one. We all need God's blessing now more than any time before in our lifetime.
Yes.
We really need to pray. We really need to ask. We really need to ask eternal life and the Holy Spirit of Jesus.
Amen.
He is in charge of all things in heaven and on earth.
Yeah, yeah.
We all need a real life which is a personal relationship with Christ.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's all about having a personal relationship with Christ. When you commit to putting yourself under his care, he ingrates you by faith.
Yeah.
And this is something which is hard to explain. But the living Jesus stands to change you and communicate with you through your spirit. A sort of your conscious counter-life sounds weird, but it's true. And very comfortable outside one. Communicating with God then becomes a continual process. Not by the formal prayers you hear in church. The Spirit makes you aware of other things around you. The Spirit makes you, it gives you direction on choices you make. It gives you power to resist the old habits you fall into. It comforts you when you are feeling down or you are falling down. When you are in tune with the Spirit, there is a peace and joy in your life, which is hard to explain.
Amen.
Amen. You know, I sometimes think that before I knew Jesus personally, there was a hole in my heart that made me feel empty and sometimes angry and depressed. Jesus brought that hole with his own presence.
Amen.
Now I feel confident, I'm purpose to deprive all the essential things and comfort that I am lacking. My daily adventure is to communicate with him and pay attention before I do anything and open my big mouth. A fellow human being like you, I'm also not insensitive to worry. I'm not insensitive to anxiety. I'm not insensitive to fear. I do also make innocent mistakes. I do occasionally get into avoidable problems, which give me the impression that sometimes I feel like running away. But at that moment, I fight that tempted spirit and surrender the rest to Christ without losing confidence in him. Because I know that he is able. One thing you have to understand is that there is nothing that can happen to you without his knowledge. And as long as your conscience is clear, you have little to worry about what is meant to teach you something and make you a better person. When I do things this way, the results are far better and my relationship with others is so much more positive. Trying to do things for Jesus doesn't work. You can't do things for Jesus. But let him do things with you and do you work wonderfully. That is the message I'm trying to put across to you. That we are called to be free in Christ.
Amen.
Free from under the yoke of the law. Free to be the people God created us to be. When you follow Jesus, it guides you into loving God and loving others as you go throughout your day together. Sure, the last time, when he said to follow his direction, but he doesn't condemn us. His patience and love for us are constant. And that's why we believe that being a Christian and being in a relationship with Him, the gospel is so simple. Most people miss it. Can we all please take our Bible and let us read together some of this morning, which we find in the book of Galatians 5. Can we open our Bible, brother? Can you open your Bible to Galatians 5? I'm going to be reading from verse 15 to 26. I want all of us to read together. Galatians 5, I hope you all get our Bible with us.
Amen.
Are we ready? Galatians 5. I'm going to read from 16. Galatians 5. I'm going to read from verse 16 to 26. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, envy, strife, jealousy, and bout of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, about things like this, of which I forewarn you, just as I have forewarned you, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God.
Amen.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against those things, there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with his passion and desire. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. Let us not become powerful, challenging one another, envying one another, because that's the Holy Word.
Yes.
How then can we walk by the Spirit? And what about with eyes and the same thing happening around us in the past few months? And this walk in the Spirit, this genuine Christian walk, is one of humility and self-desire. It is not marked by an insistence of having one's flesh desires met. No, it is one of self-righteousness, antinomianism, or legalism in Christianity. Antinomianism means one who takes the principle of salvation by faith and divine grace to the point of accepting of claiming that the saved are not bound to follow moral laws, like you members we have today, believing in their own righteousness and sense of judgment, without any need for spiritual guidance from any force. But we don't need any law. Salvation is free. Salvation is not free, my brother. The one who do walk in the Spirit are fearful of God.
Amen.
Not haughty, not easily angered, and they are always penitent. They walk in repentance and God will grow them in holiness. The Holy Spirit manifests the fruit of the Spirit in them, and they have crucified the flesh. Their focus is in their work is to do all the glory of God with no desire for self-recognition or self-aggrandishment. I explain that all the baptism expected from us, if we want to walk to follow Jesus without looking back, as we have been above, will not discourage us. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, is joy, is peace, is patience, is kindness, is goodness, is faithfulness, is gentleness, is self-control. Against those things there is no law. And now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified his flesh with its passion and desire. if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit.